If you pull out your message notes inside your program, all your life you've heard about the three wise men of Christmas. This year I want to talk to you for just a second about the three wise women of Christmas. You maybe have never realized that there were three wise women, but there were. One of them was married, one of them was single, and one of them was widowed. The first one was named Elizabeth, the second one was named Mary, and the third one was named Anna. Every one of these three wise women faced a major obstacle in their life. Elizabeth faced major disappointment. She was old and unable to bear a child. She had been childless her entire life. Big disappointment. Mary had to face a major change. She's pregnant and she's single. How is she going to explain that? And Anna had lost the love of her life, her husband, just a few years into her marriage, and so she had to deal with loss. So disappointment and change and loss were the three things these three wise women had to deal with. But they all overcame each of those because they were wise. Elizabeth overcame resentment and bitterness. Mary overcame her fears. And Anna overcame her grief because they all made wise decisions by making wise choices. How do you know when somebody is wise? How do you know when somebody is really wise or not? By looking at the decisions they make. Wise people make wise decisions. Foolish people make foolish decisions. Unwise people make unwise decisions. If I want to know if you are wise, if you're truly a wise woman, if I want to know if you're truly a wise man, all I have to do is say, tell me about the decisions you've made in your life. Because your decisions reveal whether you are wise or not. The Bible says this about the wisest man who ever lived. His name was Solomon. He was the king of Israel because God gave him wisdom. Because when God said, I'll give you anything you ask for, he didn't ask for money, he didn't ask for fame, he didn't ask for comfort. He said, God, I want you to make me wise. And he became the wisest man in the world. And the Bible says this on the screen, 1 Kings 3:28, the people saw that Solomon had God's wisdom by the decisions he made. What I want us to do right now is look at the three decisions that these wise women made. Because if you want to be a wise woman or you want to be a wise man, you need to make these exact three decisions this next year and for the rest of your life. So first, we're going to start with the first wise woman. If you want to write her name in, if you're taking notes, the first wise woman of Christmas is Elizabeth. We find her story in Luke chapter 1. We find Mary's story in Luke chapter 1. And we find Anna's story in Luke chapter 2. Now, on your outline, the Bible says this. When Herod was the king of Judah, there was a priest named Zechariah, and his wife was named Elizabeth. Both Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous and godly people. This is what God says about them. Their lives pleased God. Circle that. Their lives pleased God because they always did everything God commanded. And they lived with a clear conscience before God. But they had no children because Elizabeth had been unable to conceive. And now they were both too old. Now, in these couple of verses, we learn a couple things about this first wise woman. First, we learn that Elizabeth was a very strong woman. She's mature, she's strong, she's godly, she was a woman of God. She was probably a great mentor to young girls. Probably a great mentor because she's very strong in her faith. Verse 6 says, her life pleased God. You know what, as your pastor and coach, that's what God, I want God to be able to say about you. That your life pleased God. That's what it means to be a godly woman. That's what it means to be a godly man. Your life pleased God. That's the highest compliment. There's nothing better than that. The Bible says she was righteous. The Bible says she was devout. The Bible says she was dedicated. So we know she was a wise woman. But the second thing we learn in this is that she's carrying a lifelong heartbreak, a lifelong hurt. The Bible says in verse 7, they had no children. And many of you can identify with this hurt, with this heartbreak. For some reason, it hasn't happened. You've always wanted to be a mother, or you've always wanted to be a father, but it hasn't happened so far in your life. The Bible says that Elizabeth was pleasing to God. She did everything right. She was a woman of integrity. But the hurt and the heartbreak in his heart is that her greatest prayer had not been answered. And this means that Elizabeth had every temptation to get bitter. She had every temptation to get resentful against God. Because she could say, you know, God, I have served you my entire life. I have lived for you. I've done what's right. I've tried to do the right thing. I've tried to honor you and worship you and love you. And yet you haven't answered my biggest prayer. I want a baby. Now, this is a great temptation to be hurt and to be bitter and to be resentful. You could probably think about something in your life you've prayed about a lot, and it just hasn't happened yet. You can be bitter or you can be better. You can trust God or you can get mad at God. And Elizabeth, in her wisdom, did not get mad at God. But the point I want to make here is that living for God does not guarantee you a hurt-free life. God never said that everything's going to happen the way you want it in life. This is not heaven. I've told you this so many times. Don't expect heaven to be on earth. In heaven, there is no sorrow, no suffering, no sadness, no problems, no pressure, no pain, no disappointment, no tears, no grief, no loss. None of these things are in heaven. But this is earth. And on earth, everything is broken. Not everything God wants to happen happens. Because the Bible says the Lord's not willing that any should perish, but people perish all the time without Christ. God doesn't want people to sin, but they sin all the time. God gives us that choice. And so to expect heaven on earth is going to set you up for disappointment. Nothing works perfectly on this planet. I've told you this many times. The weather doesn't work perfectly. The economy doesn't work perfectly. Your relationships don't work perfectly. Your body doesn't work perfectly. Everything is broken. Living for Christ does not guarantee a pain-free life. In fact, Jesus said just the opposite. He said, in this world, you will have trouble. Not might. Not might. Not could happen. It says you're going to have trouble. So we shouldn't be surprised when things don't always go the right way. We shouldn't be surprised when we have pain in our lives because it's not heaven. But Elizabeth had wanted a baby all of her life, and it hadn't happened. Now, we pick up her story in Luke chapter 1, starting with verse 8, and this is the story of the miraculous birth of John the Baptist. Elizabeth was the cousin of Mary, and she was the mother of John the Baptist, who was the forerunner or the announcer of the Messiah. Here's what it says on the screen. One day, Zechariah was chosen to enter the temple of God to burn incense. He was a priest. While he was doing that, a large crowd of worshipers stood outside the temple praying. But inside the temple, an angel appeared to Zechariah, standing at the right side of the incense altar. When Zechariah saw the angel, he was startled and overwhelmed with fear. But the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your persistent prayers have been heard." Now, we'll come back to that. You might circle it. Your persistent prayers have been heard. "And your wife Elizabeth will finally conceive. She'll bear you a son, and you are to name him John. This boy will not only bring great joy to you, but many other people are going to be blessed by his life too. And they'll celebrate his birth one day. John will become a great man for the Lord." Later, Jesus would call John the Baptist the greatest human being that ever lived. God said John the Baptist was the greatest human being that ever lived. "John will become a great man for the Lord. He is never to drink any wine or any other alcohol, And God will fill him with his Holy Spirit even from birth as a baby. And God will use him to bring many people back to the Lord. He will preach with the Spirit and the power of Elijah. And he's going to reconcile fathers and children. He's going to put families back together, restore harmony in the home. And he's going to get disobedient people to think and act in the right ways again. And this will prepare the people for the coming of the Messiah. Those of you who are old enough to remember Johnny Carson, anybody remember him? And Johnny Carson's sidekick was who? Ed McMahon. And everything on night TV, he'd go, here's Johnny. He was the announcer. John the Baptist was the announcer for Jesus. Here's Jesus. He's coming. He's going to be here. Get ready. This will prepare the people for the coming of the Messiah. But then Zechariah said to the angel, how am I going to know that what you're saying is true? I can't believe he's doubting an angel. Okay, but he goes, how am I going to know what you're saying is true? He's doubting. He says, I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years too. Notice how polite he is to his wife. Says, I'm an old man. He doesn't say, and I'm married to an old lady, an old woman. No, he says, and my wife's old in age too, or up there. He's very polite. Then the angel answered, I am Gabriel. I'm Gabriel. I stand, he's an archangel. I stand in the presence of God. And God has sent me to tell you this good news. But because you've doubted my words, you're going to be struck silent and unable to speak any words until the day that Elizabeth delivers her baby. But every word that I've told you will happen at just the right time. Now, meanwhile, all the people outside of the temple are wondering what's taking Zechariah so long. He's just going in to light incense. And the people weren't allowed in the temple. Only the priest could go in the temple, and in the Holy of Holies, only one day a year on the Day of Atonement. But when he came out, Zechariah couldn't speak a word. So they realized that he'd seen some kind of vision in the temple. Zechariah kept making signs to them, but he was unable to speak. Now, in this passage, we learn two more things about the wisdom of the wise woman named Elizabeth. First, we know, verse 13, he says, your persistent prayers have been heard. So we know that Elizabeth and her husband never stopped praying. Never, even after they were physically unable to conceive, they kept praying. This is a mark of wisdom. Even in all of her pain, even in all of her disappointment, even in all of her dashed hopes, even as she got older and older, she kept on praying. That's a mark of wisdom. And in verse 20, when Gabriel says, every word that I've told you will happen at just the right time, we know that Elizabeth also understood the timing of God is better than my own timing. She understood what it meant to wait on God's timing. She had her timetable for a baby, but God had his timetable for a baby. She had her plans. And she knew that she could trust God and she could trust God's timing. Both of these, praying persistently and being patient, are marks of wisdom. That's why Elizabeth is a wise woman. Now, there on your outline, it says this, Luke 1:24. Sometime later, Elizabeth became pregnant. This is a miracle. Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months, she never left her home. Okay, she isolates herself. She's housebound. She never left her home. I think this is probably she's just being careful and smart with her pregnancy. I'm an old woman. I don't want to miscarry. I'm going to just stay home because God's given me this miracle baby. But she kept praising God all these months, saying, the Lord did this for me, and he has shown his blessing and has taken away my shame and pain. Now, she gives all the credit to God. And he says, God has taken away my pain and my shame. Why would she be ashamed of not having a baby? Well, because she lived in a very different culture than ours. And 2,000 years ago, a woman's value was largely determined by how many kids she produced. And if she produced a big family, she was extremely valuable to that family. She was considered the mother of future generations. Now, that's not true today. But she felt the shame of the culture of that day because she was unable to have children. If you had a lot of kids, you were highly valued. If you had a few kids, okay. If you had no kids, well, there was a pallor, there was a shame on that. She said, God has taken away my shame. Now, we pick up the rest of the story in verse 57. Look up here on the screen. When Elizabeth gave birth to her son, her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had blessed her. All three of these women get the word blessed in their life. You want God's blessing, you make wise decisions. I'll say it again. If you want God's blessing, you make wise decisions. The Lord had blessed her, and she shared her joy. They shared her joy. Now, 8 days later, they, that's all the relatives, came for the circumcision, and they're going to name the baby after his father, Zachariah. But Elizabeth spoke up and said, no, he is to be called John. So they objected. But wait a minute, Elizabeth, you don't have any relatives with that name. So they asked his father, Zachariah, what he'd like to name the child. Zachariah asked for a writing tablet. And immediately, and to everyone's astonishment, he wrote, his name is John. This is what they'd been told by the angel to name him. Immediately, as soon as he did that, he got his voice back. This is the miracle. And he began praising God. Now, this story, the miraculous birth and Zachariah getting his miraculous voice back, this story filled the entire community with deep awe. And everywhere, everyone was talking about it and wondering, what kind of special person is this child going to be? For it was obvious that God's power was on him. Now Elizabeth understands the delay. Her entire life, she's been praying for a baby. God intended to give her a baby, but God's plan was bigger than Elizabeth's. Elizabeth just wanted a baby. God says, no, you're going to be the mother of the greatest human being ever to live, as Jesus called John the Baptist. You're going to be the mother of the forerunner of Jesus Christ. Now, to be the forerunner, John couldn't be born 30 years early or 20 years earlier. He needed to be born just about the same time, literally just a few months before the Messiah is going to be born. Now she gets it. Now she understands. All that time I've been praying, I've been thinking God wasn't hearing my prayer. Here's the point. A delay is not a denial. You need to realize that in your life. A delay is not a denial. And the difference between a wise person and a foolish person, or the difference between a mature person and an immature person, is you know the difference between no and not yet. No child knows the difference. When a child asks a parent, can I have this? And you say, not yet. They think it means no, and they start crying. Only when you get mature, only when you get wise, do you understand the difference between no and not yet. All of Elizabeth's life, she'd been wanting and praying for this to something to happen in her life that hadn't happened. Maybe you've been wanting and praying for something to happen in your life. It hadn't happened yet. It just tells me that, A, God has something bigger and better planned for you. You need to be patient. You need to trust God. Now, here is the choice that Elizabeth made that made her a wise woman. If you want to be a wise woman, if you want to be a wise man, here's the first thing you need to do. Write this down. Elizabeth was blessed because she chose to trust God's plan instead of being bitter. She chose, it was a decision, to trust God's plan instead of being bitter. What are you being tempted to be bitter about? It just means you're not trusting God's plan. You think you know more than God does. A wise person trusts God's plan and timing, even when it doesn't make sense, even when you can't figure it out. Now, the second wise woman of Christmas, of course, is Mary. And we find her story in Luke chapter 1, starting in about verse 26. Up here on the screen, it says this. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, remember, Mary and Elizabeth are related, which makes, by the way, John the Baptist and Jesus were cousins. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a young virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. Her name was Mary. Now the angel said, "Greetings, God has chosen you for a special blessing, and he is with you." But Mary was frightened and confused. This is her initial reaction, fear and confusion. And she tried to figure out what this greeting might mean. So the angel said to her, "Don't be frightened, Mary, for God has decided to bless you in a wonderful way. You're going to have a baby, and he will be a boy, and you're going to name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And God will give him King David's throne, but his kingdom is going to last forever and never end." "How can this be," Mary asked, "since I'm a virgin? I've never known a man." The angel answered, "God's Spirit will come over you, and his power will overshadow you. So the holy child that you carry will be called the Son of God. For right now, your own relative, Elizabeth, is about to have a baby, even in her old age, because nothing is impossible with God. He can do anything." Then Mary answered, "Well, I am the Lord's servant, and I accept whatever he plans for me. May it happen as you have said." This is a surrender, it's a submission. So the angel left her. Then Mary got ready and traveled quickly to the town where her relatives, Zechariah and Elizabeth, lived. When Mary entered their home, she greeted Elizabeth, and when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, her baby leapt in her womb, and instantly Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Overcome with joy, Elizabeth exclaimed in a loud voice, "Mary, you are the most blessed woman on earth, and the child you are carrying is the most blessed too. But why? Why am I so blessed that the mother of my Lord should visit me? The moment I heard the sound of your voice, Mary, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Mary, you are," this is the key, "you are blessed because you believed that God would do what he said he'd do." Now Mary responded by singing her praise to God. "My soul praises God's greatness, and my spirit rejoices that he is my Savior. He noticed me. He noticed me. God noticed me, his humble servant girl. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed because of what the holy God has done for me." So Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. In those days, men and women married very, very young. Mary might have been 15 years old, probably at the most 16, when she hears this news that she's pregnant. And she's filled with fear. Who wouldn't be? First, if an angel showed up, that'd scare me. Probably scare you too. But then what the angel says to her, that's even more scary. "Mary, you're going to be pregnant. You've never known a man. And the daddy of the baby is going to be God." Right. Right. Okay. So imagine all the possible fears going through her mind. First, there's a fear of criticism. How am I going to tell my mom? "Hi, Mom. Yeah, I know I'm engaged to Joseph, but I'm pregnant, and Joseph isn't the daddy. Oh, and by the way, the daddy is God, and I'm carrying the Son of God. Would your mother believe that?" Pretty unlikely. Teenage girl, "Hi, Mom, I'm pregnant, and God's the reason." So how am I going to explain that to my mom? How am I going to explain it to all my aunts and my uncles, to my sisters? How am I going to explain it to Joseph, the man I love, that I'm engaged to? "Hi, honey, I'm pregnant, and you know we haven't had sex." How am I going to explain it to the whole community? It's probably one of the reasons why immediately after she heard this news, she goes to another town for 3 months to live with her relatives, Elizabeth and Zechariah, because she doesn't want to have to explain this to everybody. It's not going to make any sense at all. So there's the fear of criticism, but there's also the fear of the supernatural. She said, how am I going to be pregnant? And the Holy Spirit, and angel says, the Holy Spirit will come over you and overshadow you. The fear of the supernatural. What's going to happen to my body? How am I going to be pregnant in this way? The fear of the supernatural. That would be a scary thing for anybody, much less a young girl. Then the fear of inadequacy. How in the world am I supposed to be the mother of the Son of God? I'm inadequate. I don't have any schooling, don't have any education. I'm just a peasant girl in a tiny village. Why me of all people? Not some queen or somebody really educated. And her sense of fear of inadequacy. And then, of course, the fear of change. How in the world is this going to change my life? She was engaged to be married. You know what an engaged girl is thinking of? Nothing but her wedding. And she's making all the wedding plans in her mind. That's what she's consumed with. And then Joseph and I will get married and we'll settle down and eventually we'll have some kids. But all of a sudden, a monkey wrench has been thrown into the plans. Her plans are out the window. It's a major, massive change. And this is fearful. But she's wise. She's wise. And in verse 37, Gabriel says, Mary, nothing is impossible with God. So she's thinking, God loves me, God chose me, God is with me, nothing's impossible with God. Okay, I can handle this. Not because my strength, but because God is with me, God loves me, God planned it. He's not going to overwhelm me with something I can't handle. And so based on the fact that nothing is impossible with God, that God's going to help her and love her, in the next verse, verse 38, she says, I am the Lord's servant. I accept whatever he plans for me. May it be according to your word. Mary wisely surrenders to the will of God. Have you done that yet? Have you wisely surrendered your life to the will of God? If you hadn't, there's a word for that, foolishness. It is unwise to go with your plan for your life when God, who created you, has a plan for your life. Wise people say, whatever God wants for my life, I'm in. I may not understand it, but I'm going to say, whatever God wants for my life, that's what I want. That's what wisdom does. And so she wants God's will more for her life than anything else. She's like David in the Old Testament. Psalm 40 on the screen. David said, I desire to do your will, O my God. Have you ever prayed that prayer? Have you ever told God, God, I desire to do your will, not mine. I desire to do your plan, not mine. I desire to fulfill your purpose for my life, not mine. That's what wisdom does. So we know that the wisdom of surrendering to God's will, God's plan, shows a mark of wisdom. And the second thing, we know that Mary was a woman of the word. She knew this book. She had many scriptures memorized. I don't have time to read the song that Mary sings spontaneously at Elizabeth's house, but it contains about 10 references to Old Testament verses. She knew this book backwards and forwards, so much so that she could, on the spot, write a song that would quote Isaiah and quote so many others in the Old Testament. Could you do that? Could you, on the spot, just write a song based on scripture verses? That's why she's a wise woman. She knew the Word of God. And if you want to be a wise man, you need to know the Word of God. The Bible says in Luke chapter 2, here on the screen, Mary quietly treasured these things, all that God told her, in her heart, and she often thought about them. That's a mark of wisdom. You think about what God says, and you think about it over and over and over. Now, here's the second key to being a wise person, a wise woman or a wise man. Number two, Mary was blessed, write this down. Mary was blessed because she chose to believe God's word instead of her fears. She chose to believe God's word, what God had said, than to believe her fears. And she certainly had a lot of fears, I'm sure, in her life. But she said, I'm not going to believe my fears. I'm going to believe the truth that God has said. Let me ask you this morning, what are you believing? Are you believing your fears? All those fears that pop in your mind, all those worries, all those anxieties, are you believing your fears or are you believing what God says in His Word? To believe your fears is dumb. To believe what God has said is wise. That's what makes wise women and wise men. Now we come to the third wise woman in the story of Christmas, and her name is Anna. And Anna is in Luke chapter 2. On your outline, it says in verse 22 of Luke 2, after the birth of Jesus, Joseph and Mary took the baby to the temple in Jerusalem to dedicate him to God because the law that God gave Moses, the Jewish law, said every firstborn boy is to be dedicated back to God. This specifically is Exodus 13:2. Now, here's the first part of the story before we get to Anna up here on the screen. Luke chapter 2, verse 25. Now there was an old man living in Jerusalem named Simeon who was very righteous and loved God deeply. God had promised Simeon that he would not die until he had seen the promised Savior of the world with his own eyes. It's quite a promise. Now on the day that Joseph and Mary arrived in Jerusalem, God's Spirit prompted Zechariah to go and wait in the temple courts. Now, this message is not about Zechariah, but I want to make this point. When God's Spirit prompts you to do something, run, because you're about to have the biggest blessing of your life. If Zechariah had not listened to that inner spirit, that prompting, go to the temple now, he would have missed what he'd been promised to see all of his entire life. No, I think I'm a little tired. I'm not going to go to the temple. I'm going to stay home and watch the ball game. I'm going to mow the lawn. I've got some chores to do. I need to clean up the kitchen. When God prompts you to do something, do it instantly. Some of you have missed amazing blessings in your life because you didn't listen to the promptings of God. You got this little inkling, this little impression that said, go do this. And it was the Holy Spirit telling you to do that. Go do this. And you didn't. And you missed a huge blessing in your life. When you get a prompting of God's Spirit, you need to do it immediately because it means God's getting ready to do something really cool, really great. So he goes to the temple, and in the temple, he finds Mary and Joseph and the baby Jesus. And in verse 28, it says this, Simeon took the baby in his arms, and he thanked God loudly, saying, Lord, now I can die in peace. As you promised me, I've now seen the Savior that you've given to all people. He is the light that you have sent to the world to reveal yourself to all people. You want to know what God's like? Look at Jesus. God sent Jesus to be the light of the world, to let us see what God is really like. You want to know what God is like? Look at Jesus. So now you've sent the light to the world to reveal yourself to all people. Now, Joseph and Mary just stood there speechless. They were amazed at what was being said about the baby. When the word there says when Simeon thanked God for the baby, the word there in Greek is the word eulogeo. Eulogeo is the word we get eulogy from. A eulogy is what we usually say about people when they die. But here, Simeon is giving a eulogy about Jesus, but he's just been born on the front end of his life. A eulogy literally means to speak a blessing, to say something good, And he says, this little baby is going to be the Savior of the whole world. He's speaking something good, and they're shocked. Now, in verse 36, we come to Anna, and it says this, that day there was also a woman named Anna, worshiping in the temple. Anna was a prophetess, and she was very old. She'd been a widow most of her life because her husband had died after being married only 7 years. So as a young bride, she loses the love of her life. Anna was now 84 years old. So she spent over 75 years alone. She's over 75 years old, and since she had no family, she never left the temple courtyards. She stayed there day and night, worshiping God with her prayers and with her fasting. Now, interesting thing here. What do you do with a blocked love when all of a sudden who you want to love is not there? You redirect it. When you have a blocked love, you redirect. If you can't have a baby and you want and you would love to love a baby, you can adopt. You can help with foster children. You can redirect your love. There are plenty of children in the world who need your love. But Anna redirects her love. She says, I've lost the love of my life. My husband, we've only been married 7 years. And she says, I'm going to redirect my love toward God. And she just says, I'm just going to worship God and love the people who come into the temple. And that's going to be my life. That's going to be my ministry. She stayed there night and day, worshiping God with prayers and fasting. Now, just as Simeon was dedicating the baby to God, Anna walked by. She paused to listen. Then Anna joined in praying for the baby, and she thanked God for sending a Savior. Now, here's the key to her life. From then on, the moment she had seen Jesus, the moment she met Jesus, from then on, Anna talked about Jesus to everyone. Anna talked about Jesus to everyone who was looking for redemption and freedom in Jerusalem. Write this down. Here's the third mark of wisdom. Anna was blessed because she made a decision. And the decision she made was she chose to focus on God's presence and talk to everyone about Jesus. She said, I've lost the love of my life. I'm alone. I'm going to use my life to focus on God's presence. I'm going to worship him all the time, love him all the time, pray all the time. I'm going to focus on presence, and I'm going to tell everybody about Jesus. That's wise. That's wise. Are you wise? Are you focusing on God? Are you telling other people about Jesus? The Bible says, he who winneth souls is wise. You know, this next week will be Christmas week. And on Christmas week, more people will come to church than in any other time of the year. And I would say to you, who are you going to bring on Christmas? He who wins souls is wise. You know, every year, this is going to be a special Christmas this year because two things. First, it's our 40th Christmas. We're celebrating the ending of 40 years. Next year, we're going to party all year on our 40th anniversary. But this will be our 40th Christmas. But second is, I'm going to do a message unlike I've ever done before. The message I'm doing for Christmas this week is called, Next Time, It's Going to Be Different. And I'm going to compare the difference between the first coming and the second coming of Jesus. Because he didn't just come one time, he's coming back. He said, if I go, I will return again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. First time he came to give us hope. The second time he's coming to fulfill that hope. The first time he came to suffer for our sins. The second time he's coming to take us to heaven. There's so many other great things. It will be the greatest message of hope I think I've ever preached. But it's hopeless if people don't hear it. The good news is only good news if it gets to them in time. Why don't you be like Anna? And say, I'm going to focus on God's presence, not my pain, not my grief, not my loss. And I'm going to focus on telling people about Jesus. Now, all three of these wise women had heartaches. Okay, remember, Elizabeth's a married woman, unable to have a child. Mary is a single woman, pregnant with a pregnancy she can't explain to anybody else. And Anna is a widowed who spent most of her life without any family and no relatives. And so they have resentment and they have fear and they have grief. But they all made choices. Will you make these same three choices? Will you choose to trust God's plan instead of being bitter? Will you choose to trust, to believe God's word instead of your fears? And will you choose to focus on God's presence, not your loss, and tell everybody about Jesus? Last night in the service, there was a man who came who had never, ever been in a Christian church, ever. He was a Hindu background. And he came in, and he watched the Christmas story, and he heard this message, and at the end of the service, he opened his life to Christ, and afterwards, he went outside and was baptized immediately. Some of you need to do that now. Let's bow our heads. First, I want those of you who already know the Lord to pray this prayer. Everybody can pray it, actually, but just say, God, I'm going to choose to be wise. I want to be wise. And I want to choose to trust your plan instead of getting bitter that things don't always go my way. And the things I've prayed for don't always get a yes answer. I'm going to trust your plan and your timing. Then would you say, God, I'm going to choose to believe your word instead of my fears. I'm not going to believe my fears anymore. I'm going to believe the truth. And then will you say, God, I'm going to choose to focus on your presence, that you're close to me, you're near me. I'm not going to focus on what I've lost. I'm not going to focus on my grief. And I'm going to talk to everyone about Jesus. I want to be known for the person who talks about Jesus. I want to be a wise man. I want to be a wise woman. If you've never open your life to Christ. Say, Jesus Christ, I open my heart to you right now. I invite you to come into my life and fill it with your love and your peace and your purpose. And I want to get to know you and I want to learn to love you and trust you. And today, I accept God's Christmas gift to me, the gift of his son. I ask you to accept me into your family, and I humbly ask this in your name. Amen.